So friends, I'm heading downtown Nashville right now. You can see my windshield's not very clean. You can see the Batman building right there. And where I'm going to go is at the Municipal Auditorium, which Elvis played at, by the way. There is a museum called the Musicians Museum. I have not been in it before, but I had a friend of mine send me a video of something that is inside this museum that I've done a video on before that was torn down and missing. And evidently they took the guts of it and they have it in here. You see it says Musicians Hall of Fame at Historic Nashville Municipal Auditorium. So we're gonna go in there and take a look, friends. Stay tuned. So in Nashville, friends, they just have random speakers just around, just playing country music. Who knew? So right there is where we're going, the Country Music Hall of Fame. Elvis did play here, I think, at least twice off the top of my head. I know for a fact he played once there, at least, minimum. We're going to go to the museum right here. Let's see what's up. Let's go in. So they have a short film that I'm going to watch, friends. And once I watch that film, we'll go in. And I bought a year membership for $60. I can come as many times as I want to. So I think I'm probably going to be making some trips here to tell all the stories. Stay tuned. Don't follow me. Those are real. Really? Oh, just on that wall? Wow, incredible.
All spray painted and welded together.
That's pretty cool. So friends, this museum has got unbelievable stuff in it, and I will be making many trips and probably making many videos here. And I encourage you to go and stay tuned and see some of the crazy stuff that I saw. So friends, this is an incredible story. Edison to iPod. The evolution. A lot of people don't know that this is the very beginning of recording. Edison put it on a cylinder. We call them cylinder players back in the day. And these were up to about 2 minutes. And then they came out with what they call the Amberol. This particular one is an Amberol, which was a 4 minute. So it started here and then of course went to the flat record player in the 78 version. And then they added 45s and 33s, tape. All these different players. Look at this. Little playtime. Look at that. This type player. I bet you some of you, if you're my age, you're familiar with this. Record players to jukeboxes to AM and then AM FM. Full size jukebox. Regular reel to reel. And then you jump over here. I actually got one of these for Christmas. It'd been in the 70s, 75, 76, something like that. This was an AM radio that you could flip open and listen to. It had a speaker on it. I actually got one. And you have all these different record players. And then you come all the way around here to an iPod. After you see this stuff, you've got, look at that, Elvis, 8-track, cassettes, TVs. And all of it comes down to that now, which is incredible. Who knew that it was going to change and do all those different things? Friends, you are not going to believe what we have here today. First, I am at Musicians Hall of Fame. I'm behind the ropes, as you can see right here. Recently I did a video about American Sound Studios in Memphis. I thought the building had been torn down and all was lost. I found out that that is not true. Mr. Glore, the guy that owned the building, his son went in the day before the building was going to be torn down in 1985, and he took the interior, the pieces to the puzzle, the parts that really make a difference from the inside of the building, and they have been in storage since 1985 in Memphis. These guys recovered it and they brought it here and they put it all back up, and that's what we found right here. And this is the famous recording, the vocal booth that was in American Sound Studios right here. But none of the guys like to record in the vocal booth. What they like to do was stand out here in front of this door right here where they could be with the band. They could get the feeling of the whole band playing. So Elvis Presley stood right here where I'm standing in front of this door and these panels right here that you see and sang Suspicious Minds, Kentucky Rain, In the Ghetto, Daddy Don't Cry, or Don't Cry Daddy. He sang all these songs right here. Neil Diamond, Sweet Caroline, right here. That's amazing stuff. That's history that just blows my mind. And it all happened right here. Now let me show you something interesting about this. They opened it, they bought this place ironically, on August the 15th, 1977, the day before Elvis passed away. They bought this studio and it became a pilgrimage for Elvis fans to go to this place and to witness it, to see it, to go inside of it. And they allowed them to sign these things. And if you look, I'll show you some close-ups of this. These things say 1970. I see 1979 all the way up to 1985 on these, and they allowed them to sign it. But something that's interesting here is Chips Moman actually created this thing where you could turn it. You'll hear my voice change. You hear the sound of my voice change, where they could turn it and it would absorb sound, or they could flip it like this and it would reflect sound. You hear my voice change right there. So this was a Chips Moman ingenious design where, depending on what they were recording, if they were doing vocals or if they were doing music, they could flip it depending on what they needed to do. So it is right here in the Musicians Hall of Fame under what is this place called?
Municipal Auditorium.
So friends, it is right here, the Musicians Hall of Fame under Municipal Auditorium, which is the big round building that you see downtown Nashville. I couldn't think of it to save my life, but my friend from Scotland right here that's filming for me, he told me, he didn't want to say it out loud. Say it in your accent.
Municipal Auditorium.
There you go. That wasn't very Scottish. But thank you so much, friends, for watching. I'm going to show you some other things that are in this display. So, friends, if you look at this picture, this is back in the day at the studio. You don't see Elvis in this picture. Just illustrates the band. And look at that back wall. That's those panels that we were just looking at. And, of course, the configuration in this museum is not exactly what was in the studio. It's just pieces of it. This is Elvis and Roy Hamilton, and if you'll notice, the same panels with the orange paint, with the white tiles. That's the panels, friends, and there's, of course, they were all around that whole studio, and they just reconstructed a piece of it and then told the story. This is an interesting picture. The guy on the left is Gene Chrisman. They call him Gino. The guy on the right is Bobby Wood, and I'm going to tell a story about Bobby Wood in a moment. Both of those guys are still alive. And that's Elvis playing Tommy Cogbill's bass. And I have a lead on where that bass may be. So I'm going to try to get a story and try to go play that bass. And then this is the whole band. And if you'll notice, to the left, you see the piano player on the far left. That is that door that you saw me standing in front of. And I'm going to put up the picture with Gene Chrisman and Bobby Wood in a moment, and you're going to see that door again better. Just in case you missed it, there is the door that I was standing in front of. You can see the window to the left of the door. That is the actual door, just like I was standing in front of. And Elvis, you see he's on a stool. He's more out in the middle, but they would push him back, and there was actually sound panels on both sides
that he would sing in between so he could still hear the band, but it wouldn't affect the microphones.
And it tells that story right here. Elvis and or any other singer seldom used the vocal booth. They preferred to stand outside the vocal booth door singing live with the band. They preferred to have a boom mic placed next to the vocal booth door to record. The vocal booth and ceiling tiles walls displayed here are the originals taken from American Sound Studio. The vocal booth and ceiling tiles on display have been in storage in Memphis from 1985 until acquired by the Musicians Hall of Fame. We credit the last owners of American Sound Studio, Mr. and Miss Bill Glore, for preserving this important piece of music history. And you remember me telling the story about Elvis, Suspicious Minds in the Ghetto, Kentucky Rain, Sweet Caroline, Willie Nelson's Always on My Mind, Billy Swan, I Can Help, Dusty Springfield, Son of a Preacher Man, B.J. Thomas, Hooked on a Feeling. These guys had something special, friends. And I mentioned Gene Chrisman. Gene played on Suspicious Minds in the Ghetto, Kentucky Rain. Also played for the other people that we've mentioned, Neil Diamond, Dusty Springfield, Aretha, Wilson Pickett, Julie Andrews, King Curtis, Herbie Mann. And Gene is still alive, still playing, friends. They call him Gino. And that is the snare drum that he used on Suspicious Minds, Sweet Caroline, Hooked on a Feeling, and Son of a Preacher Man. That is the actual snare. A Rogers. Incredible. In the ghetto, friends, Reggie Young, this is the nylon string guitar that he used on In the Ghetto. That is the actual guitar that you hear in that song. And his mama cried. So this is Elvis in American Sound Studios with the fellas. Gene Chrisman, Tommy Cogbill on bass, Mike Leach on bass. Mike is still alive. He lives here in Nashville. Bobby Wood on keys. Bobby Emmons on organ. Reggie Young on guitar. He's still alive. He lives south of Nashville. And Dan Penn, writer and producer. Now, he didn't write and produce these particular things, but that's what he did. He was in the picture. He was there that day. And that photo was taken in 1969 when Elvis was there cutting Suspicious Minds. That was Elvis's last number one single in the United States. And this bass that Elvis is holding right here, I got word that Tommy Cogbill's son still has it. He lives here. I'm going to find that bass and we're going to look at it and touch it and play it, friends.
So I told you that we would talk a little bit more about Bobby Wood, the keyboard player, and I'm going to talk about a few things. It's the guy standing here with the patch on his eye. And you're going to not believe what I'm going to tell you here in just a little bit. Not only did he play with Elvis and all those other people that we're getting ready to mention on the keyboard, he also played for many, many, many years for another superstar that you would absolutely know. So stay tuned. Bobby Wood not only played with Elvis, he played with this guy. It's going to blow your mind.
And that piano right there, that's a Wurlitzer. They call it here, they call it a Whirly. That was used on the Kenny Rogers song, Lucille. You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. That's The Way Love Goes by Merle Haggard. Somebody Done Somebody Wrong song by B.J. Thomas. You Look So Good in Love by George Strait. Everlasting Love by Carl Carlton. Bobby Wood played that particular Whirly on all those different ones. Amazing. So friends, I wanted to talk about Bobby Wood for just a moment. Bobby Wood was born in 1941. And he was one of the band members at here at American Sound Studios. And you can see he played with Elvis, Dusty Springfield, Herbie Mann, Wilson Pickett, Sweet Inspirations. He was what they call a first call musician. He played on sessions for Chris Christopherson, George Jones, Tammy Wynette, and Billy Crash Craddock. all kinds of different people, and he played in the studio. And this is him right here in this picture. You see him on this corner. That's Bobby Wood. Now, something that's incredible is Bobby went on to play for another superstar right around the corner here. That's Bobby Wood right there. And the superstar is Garth Brooks. Bobby played this keyboard on Garth's albums between 1994 and 2016. It can be heard on She's Every Woman, The Beaches of Cheyenne, Long Neck Bottle, Two Pina Coladas, To Make You Feel My Love, and You Move Me. So Bobby Jones, the same guy that was at American Sound Studios, been with Garth all that time, friends. Just another little tidbit, tying it all together for you. Amazing stuff.
So friends, if you watch my previous American Sound Studios video, I made a mistake in that video by calling the producer Chip Moman. His name is Chips Moman, like laying down all my chips on this. It's Chips Moman.
And all these are real, friends. I told you how many there were, an incredible amount.
So friends, if you're in Nashville, definitely go to this place. It's the giant round building you see downtown Nashville, Musicians Hall of Fame at Nashville Municipal Auditorium. Elvis actually played there, and their displays are incredible. I encourage you to go.
This place is incredible. I will be spending a lot of time here, and I recommend that you do the same. You need to come here. This is a great place. You can even get a year-long pass where you can just come in here and look and do different things. But this is incredible. I thought all was lost, friends, but all is not lost. People like the guy that curates this museum, that did this, it's amazing to me that people were smart enough to realize the history of all this and to preserve this. I thought it was gone, and I know you did too, but you can come here and see it, and you can even touch it. Even though I'm over the ropes, they'll let you touch that right there. That was in this studio when those songs were cut. Thank you so much for watching, and tighten up every chance you get.